Good morning. Welcome to Holy Innocence, and we welcome you, all the fathers, today as we celebrate Father's Day. And today also we celebrate Acceptance Sunday. It's a day that we established in Holy Innocence years ago, where we talk about learning to accept one another and how God created us. And especially during this month of the LGBTQ celebration of Pride and the advances that have been made for that particular community. So let us prepare for our Mass as we listen to our opening hymn. Once again, good morning. My name is Bishop Frank Betancourt, and I'm pleased to celebrate this morning with Father Dante Tarantini. We are coming to you from Long Island, and we are celebrating today, as I mentioned earlier, Father's Day, the LGBT community's celebration of Pride Month. And also, we're going to remember the soul of Sarah Van Blarkum, who passed away recently at a young age. Let us keep in mind, and also those intentions that you may have for us today. And we begin, as always, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The great kindness of Almighty God, the embracing love of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the Spirit of truth and unity be with you.
And also with you.
Jesus asked us to be his witnesses to the world. And we often lack the courage to witness openly to the truth in the love of Jesus Christ that embraces all people. But Jesus tells us what he said to his first disciples: do not be afraid. So let us now bring our fears to him and ask his help in overcoming them. Lord, you rescued the life of the outcast from the power of the wicked. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, you tell us not to be afraid, for the Father has knowledge of the sparrow that falls to the ground. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, your grace and gracious gift overflow to all people. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And by the authority granted me through Jesus Christ and his disciples, I absolve you of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I absolve you of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen. And let us pray. God of the universe, we worship you as Lord. God, ever close to us, we rejoice to call you Father. From the world's uncertainty, we look to your covenant. Keep us one in your peace. Secure us in your love. Help us to learn to accept one another as you created us. And bless all fathers this day. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Now let us hear the word of God.
Our first reading is from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. Jeremiah said, I hear the whisperings of many, terror on every side. Denounce, let us denounce him. All those who are my friends are on the watch for any misstep of mine. Perhaps he will be trapped. Then we can prevail and take our vengeance on him. But the Lord is with me. Like a mighty champion, my persecutors will stumble. They will not triumph. In their failure, they will be put to utter shame, to lasting, unforgettable confusion. O Lord of hosts, you who test the just, who probe the mind and heart, let me witness the vengeance you take on them. For to you I have entrusted my cause. Sing to the Lord, praise the Lord, for he has rescued the life of the poor from the power of the wicked. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our responsorial psalm is, Lord, in your great love, answer me.
Lord, in your great love, answer me.
For your sake I bear insult, and shame covers my face. I have become an outcast to my brothers, a stranger to my mother's children, because zeal for your house consumes me, and the insults of those who blaspheme you fall upon me. Lord, in your great love, answer me. I pray to you, O Lord, for the time of your favor, O God. In your great kindness, answer me with your constant help. Answer me, O Lord, in the bounty of your kindness and your great mercy, turn towards me. Lord, in your great love, answer me. See, you lowly ones, and be glad. You who seek God, may your hearts revive. For the Lord hears the poor, and his own who are in bonds he spurns not. Let the heavens and the earth praise him, the seas and whatever moves in them. Lord, in your great love, answer me. The second reading is from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, through one man sin entered the world, and through sin, death. And thus death came to all people, inasmuch as all sinned. For up to the time of the law, sin was in the world, though sin is not accounted where there is no law. But death reigned from Adam to Moses, even of those who did not sin after the pattern of the trespass of Adam, who is the type of the one who was to come. But the gift is not like the transgression. For if by the transgression of the one, the many died, how much more did the grace of God and the gracious gift of the one man, Jesus Christ, overflow for the many. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia, 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 alleluia. The Spirit of truth will testify to me, says the Lord. And you too will testify. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Bishop, be blessed.
Granted, may the Holy Spirit descend upon you, fill your mind, your heart, and your lips, that you might worthily proclaim the gospel of the Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to the 12, Fear no one, nothing is concealed that will not be revealed, nor secret will that not be known. What I say to you in the darkness, speak in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops, and do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in Gehenna. Are not two sparrows sold for a small coin? Yet not one of them falls to the ground without your Father's knowledge. Even all the hairs of your head are counted. So do not be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Everyone who acknowledges me before others, I will acknowledge before my Heavenly Father. But whoever denies me before others, I will deny before my Heavenly Father. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. The This morning I'm going to do something just a little bit different. I don't know if it's so much of a homily, but a witness. I'm going to be talking a little bit about myself to you and my experience in life. And hopefully it will flow through and teach you what the gospel is telling us today. To trust in God and to care for one another. There's a poem that has always stayed in my mind. I read it many years ago. And perhaps some of you have heard of it. It's called Children Live What They Learn. And there's been many different interpretations of this beautiful poem. But here's the one that I remember. If a child lives with criticism, he learns to condemn. If a child lives with hostility, he learns to fight. If a child lives with ridicule, he learns to be shy. If a child lives with shame, he learns to be guilty. If a child learns to have tolerance, he learns to be patient. If a child lives with encouragement, he learns confidence. If a child lives with praise, he learns appreciation. If a child lives with fairness, he learns justice. If a child lives with security, he learns faith. If a child lives with approval, he learns to like himself. And if a child lives with acceptance, he learns to find love in this world. This holds true for each and every one of us. For what we are and what is what we've learned in life, and the values we were taught, and how we eventually learn to rethink them and accept and reject whatever was presented to us. That poem causes me to reflect on my life. And all that I can recall, the good and the bad. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about my life experience. I grew up in Philadelphia in a white, mostly Irish neighborhood. My mother was Irish, my father was Cuban. My grandmother, off the boat from Ireland, as they used to say. She didn't like my father, and with her great brogue, she called him a dirty foreigner. It was difficult, and it was very hard for me to understand that. Because that was, to me, associated with my father's skin, which was not sparkly white. Maybe his accent, other things from his culture. My dad's family were different from the other people in the neighborhood that I used to see. They were Spanish. Their skin was a little bit darker, and they spoke Spanish when they came to the house. And for those of you who are with me that are Spanish, when I was a kid, when I would hear them speak, they would speak so loudly with such excitement, I always thought they were mad. But it was just the liveliness of their nature. I was taught to stick to your own kind. There were the different names that we called people, and forgive me, but blacks were trouble. And they were going to hurt the world. Italians, they called them WOPs. They were always criminals. The Irish mix, they were drunkards. The Polish, Polacks, they were dumb. The Jews, kikes, money mongers, Christ killers. And these distinctions went on and on and on, and that's all I ever heard about. You know, Catholics were thought to be the only true faith, and that was what was taught. We need a special permission if we were going to attend a service in a Protestant church, for example, a wedding. We had to go get an okay to step foot in the Protestant church. And we had to cross the streets if we were ever going near a synagogue. We couldn't even walk on the same sidewalk. I think I was in the fourth or fifth grade when I had the first feelings that I was different. Later in life, I understood that difference was called gay. I had to keep it quiet in those days. As some people may find in their families or communities, they have to do today, although it's much easier today. LGBT people were made fun of. I had a cousin named Junior. He was older than me, he was gay, and he was always made fun of by my family and his family. He was the joke. Eventually, he moved to San Francisco to get away from everyone. When I was in the sixth grade, I remember I had a nun who must have noticed something about me, and she insisted not on calling me Francisco, but she called me Francesca. And I finally asked my dad, what does that mean? And he said, that's the girl's name for your name. And so I felt embarrassed whenever she called me that name. I was so scared people would find out. I was ashamed. The climate was different than today. In high school, I was tormented by one of the brothers who must have sensed that I was different. And he always used to punch me on any occasion that he could. I always tried to avoid him. And he was always yelling at me to toughen up. Toughen up, Betancourt. And he would always tell me that I was going to amount to nothing in life. Well, maybe I look at myself today and maybe I can say to him, well, maybe I didn't. I had my share of being beat up, once receiving a concussion, have been hit on the side of my face with a board, falling on the ground, and next thing I realized I was on the steps of my home. I had a black friend named Lundy Harris. He was a very nice guy, but I wasn't allowed to bring him home. You did not mix with those folks, is what I was being told. Yes, he was in the minority, and you know, perhaps the only black child that I knew in school. And yet, perhaps we found this bond of friendship because we both felt that we were outcasts. When I entered a Franciscan community, I lived with black people. There's Brother Claver and Brother Regis and Brother Xavier. And it was the first time that I was able to mingle freely and openly with people of another color. And that's when I was in my 20s. I felt acceptance. We didn't talk about our effectual preferences in religious life. None of that was to be discussed. Life continued to raise its ugly face, and I experienced so many other things in life. When I got together with Dante, his family was more lenient and more accepting. My family too accepted us. I really shouldn't say accepted. They tolerated us more, the adults. But things got worse when we brought foster children into our lives who were living with HIV and AIDS. Some of these children were children of color. They were Irish kids, they were African American children, they were Puerto Rican children. I was still told, stick to your own kind. You can come home, Dante can come with you, but don't bring them into our house. That was my experience. And the last time I had seven brothers and sisters and my mom was still alive, it's been some 32 years since I heard from any of them. I had one sister. But I do have some wonderful nieces and nephews and great nieces and great nephews who found Dante and I, and they're such wonderful people. They love us for who we are, and we love them. It's so good to have blood family in your life as well. I was held up for promotion when I was in college, teaching as a professor by both the chair and then he became provost. Our cars were vandalized, the tires were slashed, fag was carved into the hood of our car. We were tortured by neighbors who banged sticks on their ceiling in the apartment below us all the times during the day and night, making fun of us. And at one time, one fellow, when I left the apartment, he forced his way into the apartment and confronted Dante and one of our children, screaming and yelling abuses at him. All of this, I believe, strengthened our faith in God, because that was the only being that we truly felt cared for us, trusted us, protected us, accepted us. It's difficult in life when you're made to feel that there's something wrong with the way God created you. But we firmly believe that God will continue to take care of us. You know, as a child, I used to console myself by listening to records, 33 and a third, or more 78, if some of you remember that style of record. And I used to love Mahalia Jackson, especially the beautiful hymn that she would sing, that his eye is on the sparrow. And today in our reading, and in other readings, we do hear how God cares for the least of them, the birds of the air, for they need not sow or reap in that beautiful gospel. And today we hear that God knows every hair on our head, and God knows even the sparrow before it falls to the ground. You know, it's not easy to be a true Christian, because as true Christians, we are called to love one another. There are no exceptions. God expects us to care for each other, no matter our color, no matter our sexual preference, no matter our political party, especially in the climate we are dealing with today. You know, we can speak justice without having that sound as if we're speaking political. But we should be outraged at the things that are happening in our world. Not just here in this country, but other countries as well, where there are such injustices, where women are still treated as property, where children are being sexually abused. where there's war and famine and hatred. We should be outraged as Christians, because that is not how we are called to treat one another, to cause others to feel less than who they really are. I often find it very difficult, although I do celebrate, as I did the other day when the justices passed laws permitting LGBT people to keep their jobs. They could be fired for how God created them. But isn't it a shame that God created us all equal, and yet we have to find laws to allow people to have civil rights, to allow people not to be fired, to allow people to vote, and so forth, all the different laws that had to be passed to allow people different from other people to have the same rights. That's unheard of. That's very cruel. When the scriptures speak to us about fearing God, what it is actually saying to us is not just be afraid what God sees us doing. It tells us to gain wisdom. We should fear God because we want to be able to please our God. Our God is watching us. So we should teach our children and one another how to celebrate our differences, not accentuate them as a reason not to care for each other. I went through some rough times, as I'm sure many of you have, and those times probably came through your mind as I was speaking to you. But let us remember that despite what others do to us, that our God is ever faithful to us. Our God cares for us. For his eye is on the sparrow, and he watches over us. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
watch me over you and me. I sing because my soul is a happy.
Now let us offer the prayer of the people as we bring to the ears of our God the needs of this community, and also reflect on those needs and those prayers, send them out to us and to one another from your hearts, those things we should call to God's mind.
So let us now turn to God for his timely help and his great kindness in our needs and concern as we pray, Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help.
Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help.
For all Christians, that their lives may bear witness to the all-embracing love of Jesus Christ that they profess with their lips, we pray. Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. For God's blessings on all fathers and nurturing men, for their families and friends on this Father's Day, we pray. Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. For God's blessing on the LGBTQ community, for the courageous witness of equality, justice and love, we pray. Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. For all those who are persecuted because of their stand for truth, justice, and equality, that God may uphold them as their mighty champion, we pray. Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. For those who are in need of healing in mind, body, or spirit, especially Hannah Dunn, Nancy Ryan, Linda Pagato, Dominic Ziza, Carol Yaris, Conchetta Ambrosio, Reverend Laurie Mitchell, Marie White, Mark Crystal, Julie Jordan, Father Vinny, Deacon Victor, Jude Turner, Susan, Josh Armanta, Cesar Renee Martinez, Joanne Grazer, Father Michael Dakota, and all the sick of this pandemic, that the Lord in his great mercy will comfort and strengthen them, we pray. Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. For all the departed, especially our beloved dead who have recently died, Sarah Todd, Ben Barkham, and all our beloved fathers who are departed, and all those who gave their lives in the struggle for equality and justice, that they may be raised to eternal life, in our Lord Jesus Christ we pray. Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. And for your prayers today,
Let us pray for all those who are persecuted around this world, for all those who are harmed because they are different than others, that those who are inflicting all this pain will realize that they are their brothers and sisters, they are children of God, that they are hurting.
We pray, Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. And for all those prayers held in the silence of our hearts,
Lord,
we pray, Lord, in your great kindness, answer us with your constant help. God of love, grant us in all our tasks your help, in all our fears your courage, in all our doubts your guidance, in all our weaknesses your strength, in all our dangers your protection, and in all our sorrows your constant consolation. And we make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, your love is all-embracing, for you love the outcast and the strangers. Help us to end our divisions that cause so much suffering in our world, that we may live in the peace and unity of your kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
And blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us our spiritual drink.
Blessed be God forever.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice from your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his church.
Let us pray. Lord, receive our offering, and may the sacrifice of praise purify us in mind and heart, and make us always eager to serve you. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
Creator, all-powerful and ever-living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Out of love for us, he humbled himself to be born of the Virgin. By suffering on the cross, he freed us from death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us eternal life. And so with all the choirs of angels in heaven, we proclaim your glory and join in their unending hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, Heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, and the fountain of all holiness. Let your Spirit come upon these gifts and make them holy, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Before he was given up to death, a death that he freely accepted, he took bread. He gave you thanks. He broke the bread and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given up for you." And when supper was ended, he took a cup filled with wine, blessed it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the cup of my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant.
It will be shed
for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven. Do this in memory of me." And let us proclaim this mystery of our faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. In memory of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Father, this life-giving bread and this saving cup. We thank you for counting us worthy to be in your presence and serve you. May all of us who share in the body and blood of Christ be brought together in unity by the Holy Spirit. Lord, remember all your churches throughout the world. Make us grow together in love with Anthony, our presiding bishop, our Bishop Francisco, and all clergy everywhere. Remember our brothers and sisters who have gone to the rest in the hope of rising again. And we especially remember today Sarah, Todd, Ben, Balcom, and all our departed beloved fathers, and all those who have died in the cause of equality. We pray, Lord, that you bring them and all the departed into the light of your presence. Have mercy on us all. Make us worthy to share eternal life with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, with the apostles, and with all the saints who have done your will throughout the ages. May we praise you in union with them and give you glory to your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Now let us join hands. And let us offer the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and grant us peace in our day. In your mercy, keep us free from sin and protect us from all anxiety as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
May this mingling of the body and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ bring eternal life to all who receive it. Lord Jesus Christ, who take the name and mercy of your body, you could keep our blood and life from this occurring invention, but help the Lord. Sisters and brothers, this is the Lamb of God. This is Jesus who takes away the sins of the world. And happy are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
And I'll ask Father Dante to offer our spiritual communion for you.
Lord Jesus Christ, we believe that you are present in this most holy sacrament. We love you above all things, and we desire to receive you into our souls. Since we cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into our hearts. We embrace you as if you are already there, and unite ourselves completely to you. Never permit us to be separated from you. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord, you give us the body and blood of your Son to renew your life within us. In your mercy, assure our redemption and bring us to the eternal life we celebrate in this Eucharist. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Any announcements?
Well, we'll be returning back to Holy Innocents Church this coming Sunday,
right.
Hopefully.
This Sunday we'll be back at Holy Innocents, so things will look a little bit different again. So. And thank you, Father Dante, for taking care of all the technical stuff.
Oh, thank you as well. And wishing everyone a very happy Father's Day. And let's keep in mind, too, as in our prayers, all our beloved fathers who have passed, and continue to honor them always in our lives and keep our love alive for them within our hearts.
Right. Well, I hope my homily wasn't too heavy. I've been sitting here thinking, wow, well,
it was wonderful.
I hope I got my point across. And Father Dante usually watches what I say and says, run it by me before you say it. Well, today, I want you to know that I got through all those things in life. I try to tell myself and others that those experiences in life that are not that pleasant or don't seem so fair, let them be learning experiences. Let us understand that by going through those things, we're being taught how we should not treat other people, and that we would be able to share those things with other people. I have gotten through it, and I will share my little poem that I used to say years ago, and I still throw it out to Father Dante once in a while, and that's, I love myself. I love myself, I think I'm grand. I sit in the movies and hold my hand. I put my arm around my waist, and when I'm fresh, I slap my face. Okay, I got away with it.
Amen.
Amen. So, well, let's bless the fathers. Anyone that is with a father in heaven, on earth, godfathers, uncles,
grandfathers,
any male figure that was a father figure in life. We'll bless them. Raise your hands, and Father Dante, join me in raising your hands and blessing.
Yes.
Almighty God, we ask you to bless these, your fathers. You gave them to us in this life to be teachers, teachers of wisdom and knowledge and strength. We thank you for them, and we ask you to bless them. Those that are with you in the heavens, hold them close to your heart. Those of them here on earth, guide them in all they do. Send the Spirit upon them, that they may always teach your will.
Amen.
And model themselves as as Jesus Christ, your Son.
Amen.
And may Almighty God bless all of you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our Mass is ended. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another.
Thanks be to God.